Hello. Welcome back to another Pen Talk. Thank you very much for tuning in and joining me on Pen Talk as I explore the amazing, incredible wide world of pens. And you see in front of you a pen you might recognize as my large hands come into view. Yes, this is the Bayard, the vintage French pen that I showed in my box of pens a bit ago. And this is the viewer's choice for restoration. So this will be the pen I will try to restore as close as I can to its original, functional, beautiful state. So when I get a vintage pen, I spend a fair bit of time looking at it and deciding what approaches I will take to finishing it and doing the restoration in a kind and gentle manner. So one of the things that I notice is the cap is kind of gungy. It kind of goes from looking pretty nice down here at the bottom of the barrel as you transition up. The cap bands actually look pretty nice. They're probably gold filled. Then as you progress up the cap, it gets gungier and gungier. And then at the very top, it almost looks like it's not even a resin up there, or not celluloid. And the clip is pretty toasty, a lot of corrosion on it. Looked like it was a very thin gold plate, which is worn away. And I have a feeling that the top was exposed to some type of elements. So it's going to take some cleaning, and I'll go through a process of cleaning. I may use some semi-chrome up there because it has to be, got rid of a lot of stuff. And I may use something with some physical characteristics to kind of get that gunky coating off. The cap threads are in good shape. It takes less than one turn to take off the cap, but then it's small and there's not a lot of threads there to begin with. The nib, I think, is in excellent shape. 18 karat, nice heart-shaped breather hole. Your classic comb feed, obviously made out of hard rubber or ebonite. And as we showed in the other video, it's a nice soft nib, so I expect it will write very, very well. As we try the lever, which is always a dangerous thing to do with a vintage pen like this, we'll see that it won't move very much at all, which probably means inside is a latex sack that's probably calcified, hardened, so that has to be taken out and replaced. And normally I see if the section comes out easily, and this one doesn't. So I'll do a little bit of soaking. I'll use a rubber gripper. I'll do what I can. And again, gentle, consistent pressure, do no harm, and hopefully we can get this pen ready to show you. I'm going to show various stages. I'm not going to show the actual individual restorations. I have a video that I'll put a link up there, which I go through painstaking details. It's a half hour video of restoring two pens. And I show all the different techniques that I use, and I show them on camera. So if you need more detail, I reference that video. I talked about my big hands, and this is a small pen compared to a Pilot Metropolitan. It's extremely short. It's about, a little bit thinner than the Metropolitan, and I consider the Metropolitan a small pen. It's not a pen I could use every day because of its size, but this pen is just too cute to not bring it back into working order, and that's what motivates me. So I'm just going to soak the pen in plain water. I've soaked pens for over a week till eventually the section came out with a gentle movement. And I do have section pliers, and one time at a pen show, I had a very nice Waterman Lady Patrician, which I couldn't get the section out. So I brought it to a well-known pen restorer who used section pliers and broke the pen. I was not pleased. So, I may try a little bit of section pliers, but first we're going to definitely try the soaking. And I put a little bit of water on the other side of the section through the lever. So it's going to get water on both sides. I don't put water up very high. I just have it right to the threads because you don't want to really soak celluloid pens. Definitely not hard rubber. I keep water completely away from hard rubber pens. So we're going to set this aside and we'll visit it periodically. Stay tuned. So while we let the section soak, The first thing I do when I try to clean up a pen that's fairly dirty or gunky is I just use soap and water. I put some soapy water inside the cap and poured it out, and there was just a slight tinge of ink in the water, so there's not a lot of ink inside the cap, which is good. But just a little bit of soap and water has brought back some luster there, and it looks like the way this celluloid coloring changes is the top was always a little darker than the rest of the pen. You can see a little bit of color now in that conical finial at the top. So I'm going to continue to do some polishing and try to make the clip look a little bit better. Now I'll be back. So after washing the cap, I use this polishing pad, focusing a lot on the clip and the top of the cap, just to ensure that I removed even more grime. And this was a white pad when I started, so it did remove a fair bit of grime. I still needed some more work, so then I put semi-chrome onto this cloth. It's a shop cloth. It's pretty much made out of paper. And I polished it up. So let's take a look at the final results. I also wear a white glove when I do any work. I don't touch the pen with my fingers. I don't want oil or any residues from my hand to get onto the pen. So that's why I use rags and everything. But now, when you look at the cap, I'm impressed at how well it cleaned up. I notice very little pitting. It looks great. And the color and that celluloid is now consistent up and down the cap. As I said, the top is always going to be a little bit dark, but there's still a little bit of color there. And I'm very happy with how this turned out. And I know there's a whole controversy on wax, but I do wax my pens because I want them to stay looking this way, keeping fingerprints off and letting them be clean as necessary with just a little bit of a cloth. So far, so good. So I just want to take a quick look at the cap with some wax on it. I think it really makes that celluloid shine, and it will stay that way for a long time. So far, this has come out very nice. But my concern now is removing the section so I can replace the sack. As you can see in the background, it's still soaking. So after about 6 hours of soaking, the section still wouldn't come out. So I decided that I would try to pull nib and feed out, which usually in a vintage pen, these are difficult to get out. And you use a knocking block once you get the section apart. But I pulled the nib and feed, and I felt that would let water come back into the barrel and section to hopefully loosen it up. Put it in water for a few minutes, pulled it out, and much to my amazement, the section just pulled right out. So that's the amazing part of working on vintage pens. And I think the key point is take your time, do it carefully. And obviously I have decades of experience of doing this, seeing other people work on pens, reading a lot of pen repair books. So I put all those things together when I start a repair effort, a restoration effort. And when you look inside the barrel, we'll see what we can see. There's a very old dried sack inside of there that we will remove. So there are various tools. This is a sack scraper. I think it's a great design. It has a round end on one end, a pointy end on the other end. So that is used once you get that section out to get rid of the sack. And I add to it these set of dental tools, which I used to go to flea markets and buy them as many times as I could. Sometimes they cost like a quarter, 50 cents a piece. And they have great little ends on them, which can be used to go in and grab parts of the sack that might be in there adhered to the wall of the barrel. And I love this little screw end there that can go in there and just grab pieces and pull them out. So we're going to do that, clean up the barrel, find an appropriate sack to put in there, and think about inking it up. Sack was extremely calcified, very brittle. My guess is it was put away many decades ago, full of ink, and that ink dried and just turned that nice flexible latex sack into an ossified piece of rubber. Let's look inside the barrel and see what more cleaning we need to do. So every pen restoration I've ever done all has its own little nuances, its own little challenges. So there's a lot of sack left in that barrel that's stuck to the outside. So it's going to take a lot of gentle scraping to get all that removed before we put in a new sack. And I need to look at that pressure bar just to see how corroded it may be. So I got out some more big chunks of the sack. I think the inside of that barrel is about as clean as it's going to get. So this is the barrel without me doing anything. Yeah, it's been washed a couple times, but I really like this lever system. It has a nice little notch there that seats it securely when you push it back down into the barrel, which is always good. And no corrosion, no pitting, no staining, unlike what we found on the clip. Such is the nuances and interesting aspects of restoring a vintage pen like this. So the feed looks good. Typical vintage ebonite feed with a nice big channel in there. I always use the back end of the scalpel to scrape out that channel. You never know what might be in there, and I'm not going to be able to see it because black ink on a black ebonite feed not going to show up, but there wasn't much there. But I always like to make certain that channel is nice and clean so we have good ink flow to that nice flexible nib that I expect will put down a lot of ink. So the nib, as expected, was easy to clean up. I used these polishing pads. Put a link to the Amazon site where I buy them. So every nuanced, every vintage pen has certain interesting properties. So the end of this nib seems to be narrowed down a little bit. So I'm assuming when I reassemble it, the section will stop right there where that little bulge is. So that way the nib will be seated in the right location. And I think the tipping material is very nicely done on this nib. Like I say, I expect a very good writing experience. And one might ask, it's 18 karat gold, it's a nib. How much was that gold worth in today's market? So I have a micro scale. I'll measure the number of grains here and figure out what the value of the gold is in this nib and be prepared to see. So here's a scale that I bought just to measure the weight of gold nibs because I wanted something that was very precise. And this goes out 3 decimal places. And it's called a diamond scale, so hopefully it is extremely accurate. It has a bunch of ways to calibrate it, but it's nice that it has this cover because you don't want air movement to possibly influence the weight. So put the Bayard nib there. We'll close the cover. We'll wait for it to come to a stop, and we'll see the weight there. And now we're going to use that weight in grams to determine the value of the gold in that nib. So stay tuned. Here's the current cost of gold per gram on today's market. And here's what the value of that gold in the nib is. More than I thought it would be. So here we are with the pen disassembled and ready for reassembling and eventually inking it up. I'm going to use this number 14 sack. I have a number of them. Here's the bag full. So I'll insert it into the barrel. Mark the length. Check it to see. Up goes all the way up to the top. And then what I'll do is I'll subtract a little bit for the part of that section. And then we'll cut it to fit. But when I was trying out this sack, and I judged the size of the sack based on how easily it slides in and out of the barrel, it felt like it was a little bit being caught up in the pressure bar. Thankfully, the pressure bar was easy to remove, and it was slightly corroded, not severe, but enough that I cleaned it up, polished it, so now the sack will slide very nicely on that. And also, when I insert the sack, it will have talc powder on it, which even will make it more slippery. If we flip a pressure bar around, you'll see how it is a little bit corroded. I cleaned it up a little bit just so there was no big gunks on it. And there's that little tab that when you slide this in, the end of the pressure bar, or the end of the lever, has feet on it that slide into those channels, slide past that little push-up, and then the pressure bar won't slide out easily. But I used a forceps to pull it out. So that's the pen. Next time you'll see it, it'll be ready for inking, or ready for inserting the sack and then inking. Before final assembly, I'll do a dry run. And a few times when working on vintage pens like these, after I got this section out, it was too tight a fit to put it back in. A lot of that may have to do with dimensional stability. So I used some sandpaper to take some material off of that part of the section. It fits it into the barrel. And now it's still a tight fit, but it's certainly not overly tight. No reason for it to be overly tight. I don't want to crack the end of the barrel, which could result from that. I really like the way this lever is designed. I think they did a nice job. Definitely a higher end pen, the way that they've done it. Not something I've ever seen before. It's always fun with vintage. You always find something unique and interesting in almost every vintage pen you work on. We're going to look inside that barrel. Hopefully I can show you the feet. There we go. The feet that are on the end of that lever that slide into those sides of the pressure bar and eventually over that stop. Same design as you'll find on vintage Waterman lever fill pens. Here's the final product of my restoration from a visual perspective. I'm extremely pleased about how this pen has responded to my cleaning, polishing, rejuvenation. Very, very nice. I had hoped that the pen would come out looking great. This black and gold resin, or black and gold celluloid, really is an attractive finish, color. And I think it survived probably over a century of existence. It survived fairly well. I'd love to look this good at a century. And I think the color of those chips is probably pretty close to the original. It may have darkened up over time. So those chips may have been a little bit brighter. But even still, it looks great. The clip came out excellent, all the bits and pieces. And it's a very nice functional pen, which we will see shortly. One thing that was encouraging in this pen is the nice labeling, engraving on the barrel. So it definitely identifies the pen, including the model number here towards the end of the cap, which is 475. So we get to see definitely it's made in France. It's a Bayard. And there's their little slogan underneath of there. There's a little bit of wear there, but it's still readable. Nice. So we have the new sack attached firmly. Give a little tug. You see it doesn't move. And it's a little bit of water-based wood glue. Then I put the sack over top of that wood glue, let it set overnight. Then I put a little coating of shellac right at that edge. And I think that provides us with the most reliable method to attach the sack, in my humble opinion. Then we coat with some pure talc, which I bought many years ago just for this particular exercise. And I also put a little bit on that section to make certain it was going to slide in easily. So I align with the clip and we slide it in. It goes in nice and easy with just a little bit of resistance. And then we put the section in. It's a little bit tighter than I like, so I'm going to take a little bit more off of there. I think a little bit of shellac is there, but basically we'll just push it in and then we'll be ready for the inking. The section is now in place where it should be. Not exactly 100% lined up with the lever, but as close as I'm going to get. And once that section's in place, I'm not going to play around with it anymore. Whoever has to replace that sack in the future will deal with it. So now we're going to find an ink, fill it up. Probably going to be about a half a mil that goes into that small latex sack, but it's a small pen, small amount of ink. Definitely not a pen comfortable writing with it unposted. It posts okay. It goes on not too deeply onto the barrel. It's kind of secure. And it makes the pen length good for most hands. And the balance, I think, is even better with the cap on it. So that's how I'll use it going forward. So this is the ink I've been thinking about putting in the pen. Bought it a while ago at the Fountain Pen Hospital in New York City. I always like a good sepia ink, and I thought Aurora would make one that would be great. So we can see it's really in the brown family. Looks like some interesting shading, can get really dark, no sheen. And I did two chromatographies, probably because I misplaced one, but they both show a similar color pattern, a little bit of blue on that one. But this is Visconti sepia, and there's Aurora sepia. So you can see how different they are. But the Aurora one, I have high hopes for. Here's my first writing sample when I first filled up the Bayard. As you can see, it can flex quite a bit, which is what we expected. It's a very soft nib. But at railroads, the feed gets exhausted. And it kind of feathers a lot on this paper. The nib is very challenging. That's, to put it mildly. To me, it's the classic, real soft, vintage nib. And this may not be the best ink for it. That's kind of my conclusion. This is a challenging nib to write with. With no pressure, it's a fairly consistent writer. It's a little scratchy on the paper, but I'm certain that the users of these pens, that was typical of many of the nibs. You know, quills, I'm certain, weren't the smoothest writers. That is certainly an extra fine line, and with a little bit of pressure, it opens up. As long as you take your time with it, it's okay. But don't push it, because you can easily exhaust the feed, as we saw up here. Well, I'm never satisfied with everything, so I got to keep working and thinking about it. And I remembered that the nib and feed pulled out easily out of this vintage Bayard pen. And then I remembered a trick I saw Graham Mia do, is when he inserted the section with the sack on it, he used a rod to keep the sack straight and not twisting. So I pulled the section out. The sack looked fine. So when I reinserted it, I used this rod to keep it there. Now it's nice. Before that, the rod wouldn't slip in and out because the sack was twisted there at the beginning of it. Now it's nice and good and clean. Ready to put some ink in there. My partner wrote with the pen and loves it. And ask for a blue ink, so we're going to use that Pen BBS blue ink that I used in the V126. Stay tuned and see how that writes. So changing inks and fixing the way the sack was inserted definitely has improved the writing of the Bayard. So it just goes to prove that ink and everything else really impacts the way a pen works and writes. And that's one of the other reasons why I enjoy vintage, is it really gets me into the nuances of the pen and also makes that challenge of getting it to write as good as it should, something to work on, fun for me. Well, hopefully, finally, we've had a good conclusion to this restoration. I want to thank all of you for watching. I hope this video finds everyone safe, healthy, and happy, enjoying your pens, exploring your pens, accepting the challenges that your pens may present to you. Fun part of fountain pen ownership. We've reached the end. May you have all great writing experiences, and we'll say bye. See you soon. Maybe another box of pens.